Hello, everybody, and welcome to the almost 800 of you who have joined us already for tonight's webinar. We welcome you all, and also to the viewers who are watching this through the podcast. So before I start tonight, I'd just like to say that Emerging Minds and MHPN wishes to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land across Australia upon which our webinar presenters and participants are located. We wish to pay respects to the elders past, present and future for the memories, the traditions, the culture and hopes of Indigenous Australians. So welcome to Series 2 in what is a collaboration between Mental Health Professionals Network and Emerging Mind. We really loved providing these webinars for you, and we have a couple left for you in this financial year, which are Aboriginal children and the effects of intergenerational trauma, and also engaging children and parents affected by child sexual abuse. So please subscribe to receive your information about these webinars through www.emergingminds.com.au/subscribe. Just a little note to you in terms of how to use the platform. This platform that we're using is relatively new, so please use the purple icon to open the chat box, blue to ask the panel a question, and already I can see there are some great questions filtering through from the almost 850 of you who are online. The blue with a tick to access resources, including the case study, panel biographies and supporting resources, and we have lots of great supporting resources which we'll talk to you about throughout the night. Yellow icon will open the survey for you, and the green one will reload the page or webinar room. So welcome. Yeah, tonight we're looking at supporting trans and gender diverse children and their families. Really looking forward to tonight's webinar. And a couple of the panellists already have contributed greatly to the resources which are provided through Emerging Minds for children's mental health. So really excited about tonight's webinar. My name's Dan Moss. I'm the Workforce Development Manager. And some learning outcomes for you tonight. So really at the webinar's completion, what we're wanting is that you will be able to choose practice that acknowledges experiencing is real, and that it supports parents in accepting and affirming the child's choices and experiences. To select language which is non-binary and doesn't reinforce dominant stereotypes about gender. We'd like you to be able to discuss how to use a support plan with trans and gender diverse children and their families. We'd like you to be able to identify referral pathways and how to make an appropriately supportive referral when working with trans and gender diverse children and their families. So it gives me really great pleasure to be able to introduce tonight's panel. So first off, we've got Associate Professor Michelle Telfer, who's a paediatrician in Victoria. Michelle, I was fascinated to read the article on you in the Saturday Age on the weekend. I thought it was a really great, gave us a really great insight into the many years of work you've done in this field. And as a paediatrician, and indeed as an adolescent physician, what are the most important messages that you provide for trans and gender diverse children when they first come to your service?
Thanks, Dan. I think the first thing that we do is try and make people feel comfortable and confident in expressing who they are and what they feel they need and what they want. So creating a really safe environment for that dialogue to occur is probably the most important aspect of what we do at the beginning.
Thank you, Michelle. Really looking forward to listening to your presentation in a little while. Our next panellist is Janet Brown, who's a child and family partner in Victoria. And Janet's going to be talking to us a little bit tonight about her experience as a parent. And Janet, as a parent, can you tell us what have been the most supportive and influential messages that you have received from professionals?
I think the most important one for me was with a counsellor when our child was very stuck and she couldn't move forward with her transition. And this counsellor said to me that it's not just her story, it's our story as a family too, and that as long as we were putting her at the centre of our decisions and making her the focus, that it was okay to take the lead sometimes. And that helped me move forward, and it gave me an opportunity to bring other people in and then to bring my family forward with me.
Thank you so much, Janet. That's really great. Looking forward to hearing from you soon. Our next panellist is Dr Nicholas Brayshaw. Nicholas is a general practitioner in Victoria. I'd like to welcome you, Nick. And from a GP's perspective, could you tell us, what does good early intervention support look like for gender diverse children?
Thank you, Dan. Well, I think the first and key factor is engagement and providing a safe environment for people. It's about listening and to their experiences, validating and normalising. It's important to be adequately informed, to provide information and help to guide people and establish an ongoing relationship for support and an ongoing review.
Thank you, Nick. Our final panellist tonight is Susanne Prosser, who's a youth worker in Victoria and also the author of many fantastic resources, which she's written for Emerging Minds. Susanne, I wonder whether you could tell us about the Supporting Trans and Gender Diverse Children resources that you have developed for Emerging Minds.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. I guess I developed those resources because from my experience as a youth worker and now at some of the consultancy work that I'm doing to support Transcend, which is an organisation to support families, is that oftentimes families are having to be the educators of GPs and other health professionals. And so the resource I wrote is kind of like a 101 crash course in supporting trans and gender diverse children and their families. So, yeah, it's for GPs, but anyone who is helping and working alongside a family. And one of the key things, it's also useful for families as well to be educating themselves with that resource too. So there's also a template in that resource that will guide a conversation around affirming a child's gender. So it is about giving everyone a tool to guide their conversation.
Thanks so much, Susanne. Okay, so tonight our presentations are going to involve the case study that you've all read about Jeremy. So Jeremy is an 8-year-old child, mother Nicole and father Michael. Jeremy was assigned male at birth, but recently has told his mum Nicole that he wants to dress in girls' clothes. Jeremy has been getting bullied at school as a result of this, and Nicole is really worried about Jeremy's mental health. And so she takes Jeremy along to see her local GP. And so without any further ado, I'm going to hand over to Michelle for her presentation. Thanks, Michelle.
Thanks, Dan. And really, in terms of the case presentation, I'm going to set the broader scene around children and young people presenting for care. One of the things we've seen over the last 10 years is a rapid increase in numbers of young people being referred to general practitioners and specialist services for care. And there are some key research papers that look at the incidence of young people identifying as trans, gender diverse, non-binary in the community. One of those studies comes from Australia, the Australian Secondary Students and Sexual Health National Survey, which was done in 2019. And this survey showed that 2.3% of young people reported being trans or gender diverse. And very similar results came from a study in New Zealand where they looked at adolescents in their adolescent health survey in 2012, and 1.2% reported being transgender and 2.5% reported not being sure about their gender. And with the increasing visibility and acceptance of trans and gender diverse identities in the broader community, what we've seen is that larger numbers of young people are presenting for care and asking for assistance with regards to transition. We believe this is because they feel more safe and comfortable in doing so than they had done in previous decades. And you can see here, these are the presentations to the Royal Children's Hospital Gender Service in Melbourne, with a very rapid increase over that 10-year period. And sometimes people question about why we intervene and why we assist with transition, and why young people often who come to our services have very poor mental health presentations and poor sense of well-being. And what we know is that having mental health conditions isn't inherent to being trans or gender diverse, but comes from the negative responses that they experience on a daily basis. Things like being socially excluded, suffering from discrimination, stigma, verbal and physical abuse, with very high rates across all studies that have been done looking at these experiences in trans and gender diverse young people. And the Trans Pathway Study, which was done in 2017, showed that 80% of young trans and gender diverse people had self-harmed, and 48% had attempted suicide. So how do we reduce these poor mental health outcomes? Well, we know from the evidence that we can improve the mental health outcomes through intervention and allowing a young person to live the life that they want to live in the gender that they are. And by affirming that gender with social transition, medical transition, and for some young people, they may wish to have some surgical interventions, we know that outcomes are much improved. And this evidence was collated into a document known as the Australian Standards of Care and Treatment Guidelines, which have been published in the Medical Journal of Australia and received praise from the Lancet in 2018. So I'd recommend if anyone is looking for a lot of the detail around how to intervene and what the principles of those interventions are, then the Australian Standards of Care are freely available on the RCH Gender Service website. And there are different stages of clinical intervention, which I'm not going to go into in any detail tonight. Again, all of these, the details of these different interventions are in the national guidelines. But there is no single pathway for any young person who presents for care. For some young people, it might be an opportunity simply to talk about their gender and to explore this with a supportive person involved. For others, it may mean socially transitioning or using different ways of people expressing their gender through their clothing or so forth. But for others, they feel that they need medical intervention, and we offer that through either puberty blocking, if they're in the early stages of their adolescent development, or at a later time using testosterone or estrogen to affirm their gender in that way. One of the most common questions I get about young people and intervening in terms of medical transition is, what if a young person who does medically transition regrets this decision in the future? We all take the task of looking after young people very seriously, and of course we would always think about the long-term implications of the decisions that they make in collaboration with us. What we do know from large studies across the world is that regret rates are very low, and this is the best study to date, which showed that regret rates were actually somewhere between 0.3 and 0.6% of transgender people, and that half of those people who did regret their treatment didn't regret the treatment because they changed their sense of gender identity, but because they suffered from the societal problems associated with transition, i.e. that they may have, after transitioning, experienced more stigma, more discrimination, potentially losing their job or being rejected by their family. So when we look at the low rates of regret and the high rates of mental health conditions when people aren't supported, we need to understand that every young person who comes to us faces risks and benefits in intervening, but also risks and benefits with not intervening. And these are some of the complexities that that we take on board and work with the young people and their families to achieve good outcomes. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Michelle. Really inspiring presentation. Next we have Janet, who is going to talk about her perspective as a mother. Janet.
Thanks, Dan. Firstly, I just wanted to say that I'm speaking from our own personal story and not for other parents of trans and gender diverse children. The first slide is, as a parent, the importance of an accepting, caring and warm response from the GP is crucial. Nicole's GP may be the first person outside her family she has approached. A GP who can show genuine concern and refrain from any judgment is really important. As a parent, you don't need to receive all the answers on the first consultation. What Nicole needs is to know that she's done the right thing by reaching out, and that allowing Jeremy to set the pace and take the lead is also really important. There's some serious issues to be discussed, and it would be hoped that the GP's got an idea about those key referral pathways. Nicole may come along alone on the first appointment, or she may come with Jeremy. Each scenario needs to be tailored accordingly by the GP. It's also really important that the GP tries to avoid pathologising Jeremy's situation, as I guess one of the key supports is usually based in a hospital, which can perhaps be embedded in a more medical model of care. I asked my teenage daughter what she would want from an initial visit to her GP. She mentioned understanding, a GP who listens, is calm in their approach, does not make her feel uncomfortable or that there's something wrong with her, normalises her experience, helps her feel less alone, and reassures her that there is help available to move forward. My next slide. Having a GP who is willing to learn, work from where the parent is at, and can share some key resources is really helpful for families. The case study, I didn't think, clarified Nicole's familiarity with the issues around gender identity, other than to share the recent conversation she'd had with her child, nor how familiar she may be with terminology that I as a parent now take for granted. I would hope that the GP would be able to quickly tailor their language to the level of knowledge that she's at. If supporting a family in Nicole's situation was new to the GP, knowing that the GP was committed to learning and working with a family would be reassuring. Also, having some key resources available to provide Nicole on the first appointment would be helpful. These resources could include written and audio-visual material and contact details for peer support groups, which are often a crucial part of a family's box of tricks. Connection is everything. Particularly in the early stage of a child's journey around gender, parents can feel isolated, out of their depth and scared. Being a parent of a child at any age who is questioning or affirming their gender can be a very isolating, emotional and scary experience. There's no guarantee of support when you start sharing your family story, often due to ignorance and strong societal norms around gender in our community. As I said before, our own child was paralysed with fear and very stuck for several years. She was very private about her thoughts and feelings on this journey, and this isolated not just her, but also us from authentic conversations with our extended family, friends and community. Connecting to others through peer support groups was my lifeline earlier on, and they continue to play a really important role in my life, in both giving and receiving support. Nicole may not immediately use any of these resources, but I think just knowing that she has them can be enough, at least at the beginning. My next slide. Oops. When a child is struggling emotionally, being bullied at school and talking of self-harm, it's important to most parents that the key health professional, which is often the GP, can take the lead. Whilst gender is the core issue here, Nicole has highlighted several other serious concerns. Children who are trans, gender diverse or non-binary are known to have an elevated risk of mental health issues, most often depression, anxiety and self-harm. The earlier that family can access effective mental health support, the better the outcome is likely to be for Jeremy. Often children in Jeremy's situation question the validity of their experience, feel different and unique, and are often unaware that it is an experience shared by many other children. In my experience, many children benefit from being given the opportunity to meet up with other children going through a similar journey to themselves. And there's many face-to-face catch-ups available for children throughout many parts of Australia. Whilst it's likely the GP would make a referral to a paediatric gender clinic, there are often lengthy waiting lists for these in Australia. In the interim, a mental health care plan and access to an organisation such as Safe Schools are important considerations. Nicole's level of confidence about approaching the school directly should also be discussed. Scheduling a second and longer appointment is advisable, and if Jeremy did not attend the first appointment, it would allow the GP to show Jeremy that they are understanding and supportive. Family dynamics can be under immense pressure when a child begins to question, express or affirm their gender. It does seem that the GP knows the family well. Often family dynamics and the struggles that fathers experience, at least in the initial stages of their child's journey, are a common talking point in posts on peer support groups, for example with Transcend. I'm not a dad, but it might be that dads worry more about feeling judged. They may wonder if they were remiss in some way in their parenting role. They may experience a level of guilt and focus on a fear about the future for their child. Grief is also a common emotion expressed. Scheduling an appointment with Michael on his own would be a sensible plan. And I think acknowledgement that his feelings are important without judging him, and a referral for support should be offered, and hopefully something that Michael would take up. Formal changes around name and pronouns can be challenging practically and can often symbolise a more permanent change in the way their child is perceived by the family's larger community. Pronoun and name changes by default invite people in public publicly to share what may have been previously a very private story. Nicole and Michael may feel exposed and fear judgment from family and friends. It is likely that not everyone will be supportive. This journey can definitely place pressure on existing relationships, which may have already been under a level of strain. I think it's really important to explain to Nicole and Michael from the outset that support from them is key to improved and positive mental health for Jeremy. And finally, the key supports for us personally included our state-based gender service, which is the Royal Children's Hospital in Melbourne, peer support groups, both face-to-face and online, which include Transcend, Parents of Gender Diverse Children and the Australian Parents Group. We accessed a specialist counselling service in Melbourne, which was invaluable to us, and provided counselling support to our whole family for well over 12 months. We have a supportive GP clinic. We had open-minded and supportive teachers who, for us, actually reached out to Safe Schools without being asked. We have very supportive friends and family for us and our child. And I think we worked out through this process that sharing this story can actually strengthen existing friendships and family relationships, and it can also help you sort out who you really want in your child's life. Our child was away from school for 8 months, and it was her friends as much as anyone or anything else that encouraged her back to school. And since then, happily, and perhaps not coincidentally, two children have since transitioned at our daughter's school, and we did put a lot of work into making our daughter's transition as positive as it could be for her, for us and for the school. And finally, this is a lifelong journey and there will be many twists and turns along the way. As a parent seeking advice from the family GP who has known my child all their life, I would hope for warmth, reassurance, support, clarity and openness. To know that they will continue to work with our family over the weeks, months and years to come is a very positive first step. Thanks, Dan.
Thanks so much, Janet. Really appreciate that presentation. And a lot of what you talked about in there was really pertinent, I thought, for GPs. So it's great that we now hand over to Dr. Nick Brayshaw to talk about this case study from a GP's perspective. Nick. I think you might be on mute, Nick.
I beg your pardon. Sorry, again. As a GP, I'd approach this consultation with four priorities in mind: engagement, safety, facilitating supports and information, and that's for Nicole, Jeremy and Michael, including building a team, thinking about who else to involve and arranging appropriate referrals. And fourthly, to establish ongoing support and review. Bear in mind that recent research has found that of trans and gender diverse and non-binary Australians, 60% have felt isolated from healthcare services. 40% have had adverse experiences with services, and 25% actively avoid healthcare out of fear of stigmatisation or invalidation. And I think that's particularly concerning given the importance of access to healthcare for this group in particular. So engagement is key. It's important to listen, to validate, to normalise. I'd like to say things to Jeremy and Nicole, like, I'm really glad you came in today. It sounds like you've been having a tough time lately. There are lots of different options that I can suggest, which might be helpful depending on your wishes. Lots of children explore different gender roles. That's very normal, trying things out. A quarter of young children might be described as gender expansive, and many settle comfortably with their birth assigned gender. But from the age of puberty, gender identity is pretty much locked in, and it's very unusual to experience a major identity shift after that. So I'd say to Jeremy, there are lots of children, just like you, who feel that they have the wrong body, which doesn't fit their own self. And Michelle alluded to rates of around 1 to 2% or more of adolescents identifying as trans or gender diverse. Unfortunately, often children do get teased by people who don't understand. So it's really important that home is a safe place. And it's great that mum is supporting you with wearing different clothes and things like that. You and mum might like to expand that. Some people have a more feminine name that they prefer to be called at home. Or maybe trying out using different pronouns at home, like she and her. It sounds like dad's still trying to get used to this, but perhaps it would be useful if you'd like to invite dad to come along to our next appointment. So now we can talk a bit about some things that you might find helpful. So firstly, bullying at school is not okay. Schools have an obligation to provide a safe environment. So perhaps, mum, you might speak to your school about addressing the bullying. And if or when you're okay with mum talking to the teachers about your gender identity, the school might be able to find ways of being more inclusive and supportive. Maybe around things like the uniform that you wear, which bathrooms to use, and so forth. And the school might contact their state organisation, like Safe Schools in Victoria, for example, who can assist them with all that. But working with schools is really Susanne Prosser's area of expertise, so she might like to expand on this afterwards. I would also arrange, just trying to move my slide forward, I would also arrange either today or sometime soon to spend some time with Jeremy alone. After explaining confidentiality rules, I'd like to explore Jeremy's perspective and concerns, loosely utilising a HEDS framework. And I'd try to engage around positives in Jeremy's life, his interests and things that Jeremy enjoys. Importantly, I'd further assess the ideation of deliberate state harm, which was alluded to in the case study, and I'd develop some sort of safety plan, some strategies, at least as an interim measure, whilst awaiting to see a community psychologist. So back now to other actions which might help. I want to suggest early on that we put in a referral to the specialist gender service, There's one in most capital cities. They often have a long wait list, but if you can see them and complete their comprehensive assessment process before the onset of puberty, one game-changer option that they can offer is to potentially help you to delay your puberty, to give you time to make a decision when you're older about what sort of puberty you want. Puberty blockers can be stopped at any time, and they can allow for either for your birth-assigned male puberty to proceed just like it would have, or other hormones could be started to bring on physical changes of a female puberty instead. But time's of the essence here. Many people miss this opportunity to leave the door open. But it's great that you've raised this with me well before reaching puberty. I'd also like to talk about referral to a private psychologist who can help you working through this complicated time, including things like working out when and how to share your identity with other relatives and friends. You might like to be in touch with other trans and gender diverse kids who may be sharing similar experiences, and with support groups for parents, such as Transcend. There's some great resources like Melbourne's Royal Children's Hospital website, which carries lots of really helpful information and links. And there's some great documents which Emerging Minds have developed. And that's almost my cue to hand over in a moment to Susanne Prosser. But I'd just like to leave you with my four sort of key take-home messages, which would be, firstly, that it's a GP's responsibility to be sufficiently informed to engage with trans and gender diverse children and their families in a non-judgmental fashion. Secondly, GPs are ideally placed to be a cornerstone, providing consistent support, coordinating referrals, helping people to navigate the healthcare system. Thirdly, early referral in time to enable consideration of puberty blockers before the onset of puberty allows for the best outcomes. And on a final note, I'd like to reassure Jeremy that your GP will be here to walk this journey with you and with your family over the long term. Thank you. I'll pass the baton to Susanne.
Thanks so much, Nick, and really wonderful to hear about such supportive and informative work being going on from GPs. And yeah, next, let's hear now from Susanne Prosser, who's going to talk to us about some resources for trans and gender diverse children and their families. Susanne.
Hello. I've mentioned the resources at the beginning there, and in the pack that was sent out to you, you can see all the resources that I wrote on the Emerging Minds website. But I guess I just wanted to, talk about how you might support Jeremy and Nicole and the family, not so much from a medical point of view, but say you're a counsellor or a child family worker. I'm a youth worker by trade. And so I guess bringing that sort of more allied health kind of perspective to the conversation. So I guess to reiterate what everyone else has already said, that it's really important to keep the child at the centre of the conversation and to enable them the opportunity to make decisions about their lives as well. For so many trans and gender diverse people throughout their life and throughout their involvement with services, oftentimes their sense of agency and control can feel like taken away from them. So involving the child right from the beginning about what they think and feel and is really, really important and will help them later in life as well as they you're helping them to develop that sense of agency and control as well. And then so from this other perspective, and as Michelle has already spoken about, that the medical approach is just one part of the journey and that not everybody will necessarily go down that path. And so for you who might not be in the medical profession, there are actually lots of things that you can do to support the child. And I guess the language we use for that is social affirmation or transition as opposed to medical affirmation or transition. And some of these things have already been mentioned, so I won't spend too much time on them. But and so changing pronouns and choosing a new name, obviously, depending on the age of the child, you will need to kind of chat through the whole notion of pronouns and what they mean. Helping the child and the family to change how they look, including maybe cutting hair or growing hair. We're all growing our hair at the moment because we can't get into hairdressers, uniforms, etc. Amending documentation. So that's a really important thing in the school environment. The child and the family are ready to come out or invite people into their lives to tell everyone that they are trans. Having that documentation amended is really, really important because it can alleviate misgendering, or which is when a person is called the wrong gender, or dead naming, which is a term that trans and gender diverse people have coined to talk about using the name that they were given at birth as opposed to the one that they've chosen. And also encouraging participation in activities that align with their gender identity and supporting them to come out or invite in, as others have mentioned as well. So those are some things in terms of social affirmation that you can support. And I guess the other thing I wanted to say about this is that unfortunately, despite the best efforts of people like Michelle and others in the gender centres across the country, there is still waiting lists. So the work that you play, the role that you play in supporting children and their families while they're waiting for those medical appointments is actually really, really crucial and really life-saving. Other social affirmation things, I guess this is more about, I guess, the conversations that you might be having with Jeremy and Jeremy's family. This notion that there's no one right way to be trans, gender diverse or non-binary, that to be trans doesn't mean that you have to adhere to really strict ideas about what it is to be a feminine woman or a masculine man, that you can explore gender identity and sort of take a more expansive approach to understanding that their identity. And then, of course, talking about all the other things that make up that child's identity. You know, are they good at soccer, or do they play the guitar, or are they good at singing, or are they good at art? Sort of just helping the child to understand that there's lots and lots of things that make them up, because as they're exploring their gender identity, sometimes they can kind of get a bit single-focused, and it can help them to really understand themselves as a whole person. And to do this, you can use books and videos. There's lots of great books available. Jump online and Google some videos. There's a bookstore called Hares and Hyenas, which is Melbourne-based, but they will post things out, and it's a great, their website's really good. You can find books for children. So, yeah, try to, engage in exploration, and as Nick's already mentioned, normalise what's happening for them. So also, as you're working with the parents and carers, and I guess we've sort of touched on a lot of these things, but suggestions, encouraging the parents to keep improving their knowledge, so that the child is not always educating the parents, but also just and that the parent's not always having to ask the child questions. Encourage the social connection, which Janet already mentioned. So connecting to online peer support like Transcend Australia, you can just Google them. And then connecting locally is possible as well. There used to be an organisation, PFLAG, stands for Parents and Friends of Lesbians and Gays, and I'm not sure, but it's worth Googling to see if they're operating in your areas. And then, yes, the other two have been mentioned. But, yes, definitely encouraging the parents to meet with the school to deal with bullying. And I know safe schools have been mentioned a lot, and in Victoria we're very fortunate that you know, there's some staff at the Department of Education that can do that support. Part of the resources that you've been sent out is a list of the information that is provided by every state or territory education department support school to support trans and gender diverse children at school. So I would encourage you to have a look at that and know that policy is a really great tool for the family to take to the school, particularly if the school is not being supportive. But it's great to know that even though safe schools might not exist in every, like it does in Victoria, in actual fact, all the education departments have really taken on board this OSHA idea that they must support trans and gender diverse children. Support for dad, I think, I mean, it's the first point that I've got there is nice in principle but difficult in reality, but ground rules about not arguing in front of about the child's identity in front of the child. And probably a lot of those things are self-explanatory. But just the final thing I want to say too is that acknowledging that there is grief for parents, even for those parents that might be 100% supportive of their child, that there is a sense of loss. You know, they might have had a child that was assigned a female at birth, and now they have a child that identifies as male. And no matter how much parents try, they still will, the moment they have a baby boy, start to think about all the things that baby boy is going to do and turn into. And there's a real shift in people's thinking and an understanding about what does this mean for me now. So, having a chat through with parents and just saying to them that it's okay. It doesn't mean they don't love their child. It means this is a feeling that they're going through. So I think that's all from me. Thanks, Dan.
Thanks so much, Susanne. That was great. So now it's time for the Q&A session, and there's some great questions coming in through our chat room, being facilitated by Amelia and Josh. There's over 1,000 of you, 1,042 of you now participating. So really looking forward to this question and answer session. And we've had quite a bit of discussion in the chat room around families from culturally and linguistically diverse backgrounds, from theatre and others. So, Michelle, I might ask you, how have you worked with families who have religious or cultural beliefs that may oppose gender diversity?
Thanks, Dan. Yeah, we have seen young people and families from a wide range of cultural, religious and linguistically diverse communities. And I think it can be quite complex for certain families who struggle for acceptance within those communities. We've had young people who are have Jewish families, Muslim families, Buddhist families, fundamentalist Christian families, Catholic, like all different groups in society. Have children who identify as trans and gender diverse or non-binary, and we really, like everyone else, take each young person and their family on an individual basis and look at what their needs might be, how we can help them. Sometimes what we've experienced is that whilst the parents may be supportive of their child, they've struggled with extended family members or even had to really withdraw from community supports to be able to do that within their family. So it can be very tricky. There's often difficulties with maintaining confidentiality within groups where we're using interpreters, for example, where being trans and gender diverse may not be considered acceptable within that particular community group. So it can get very complicated, but as I mentioned, we listen, we discuss how we can assist them in a safe and worthwhile manner, and really take it from there. And I think being conscious of all of those things is probably the most important aspect, that different points of care and different aspects of care are going to be harder for some groups than others. Does that answer the question,
yeah,
Dan?
Yeah, it certainly does. Thank you, Michelle. That's wonderful. Janet, there's several questions through the chat room coming in about how do we honour the voice of lived experience as we continue to develop work with trans and gender diverse children. As someone, as a mother with lived experience, what's one of the ways that you think that professionals can incorporate the voices of lived experience into their practice and learning?
Thanks, Dan. I think while some trans and gender diverse non-binary people are happy to share their personal experience, sometimes they can burn out. And sometimes it's just as good to be able to refer people to key websites such as Transgender Victoria, Transcend, parents of gender diverse children minus 18, which are all easily accessible on Google. And they've got a wealth of resources there, whether they're, you know, stories that young people or adults have written, or whether they're actual, like, documentaries. I mentioned one that really resonated for us and our school was the Australian Story documentary about a girl, which was based on Georgie Stone's experience. And she was 15 or 16 at the time that that documentary was made. And that was used at my daughter's school as a way of educating her classmates and the 2 years above her. And it really resonated with them as a story of lived experience without that person actually having to front up and speak personally to that group of people, if that kind of makes sense.
Yeah, it certainly does. Thanks, Janet. Mick, a question for you, or several questions for you, really about developing knowledge around this issue. Questions from Christina, particularly around training and development in this area. Can you tell us, as an experienced GP, how has your engagement with trans and gender diverse children developed with your new understandings of the issue?
Yes, Dan. Okay. I think I'd like to answer that question in three different ways, if that's all right. Firstly, look, sure. It was a steep learning curve for me 12 years ago. Working at Headspace when my first transgender teenager requested assistance to transition. And I had no training at medical school or in GP training in this field. And asking my colleagues and my usual networks similarly wasn't much help. So I did manage to hunt down a few resources and to involve was very small in those days, a gender clinic in Melbourne. But I was amazed that when just a few weeks later, several of this person's acquaintances also contacted me. And soon a sort of steady trickle turned into almost a flood of local transgender diverse people of all ages. And many were desperate to find professional support. And yet they had remained invisible in my community, in some cases for decades. The second way I'd answer is that, well, nowadays there are lots of great resources available online. There are peer support groups and forums like tonight, for example. For me, joining AusPath, that's the Australian Professional Association for Transgender Health, that's been really helpful, a very supportive organisation, educational, dynamic. And the AusPath website carries several key documents, including the Australian Standards of Care for and Treatment Guidelines for Trans and Gender Diverse Children and Adolescents, which Michelle alluded to earlier. And Michelle and her team have very much been were the developers of those guidelines, which have really set a benchmark, I should say, which is recognised internationally. And they're a great place to start reading for anybody who's listening tonight. I guess my third answer is a little more reflective. So I'd like to ask each person listening tonight, really, to reflect yourselves on what other situations can you think of whereby young people with potentially happy and productive lives ahead of them face such high rates of morbidity, disability, and high mortality. And yet, a relatively simple medical support can make a world of difference. But the healthcare system is far from forthcoming or easy for them to access. How unjust does that reality feel? I guess, and it leaves me contemplating what could each of us do in our practices to help address that gap.
Thanks so much, Nick. Suzanne, a question from Sophie and others actually is what can schools do to become more inclusive of trans and gender diverse students, and particularly thinking about minimising the mental health effects on those children?
Yeah, sure. Lots of things. I think a lot of the stuff I mentioned earlier around supporting social affirmation are things that schools can do. So that's really important. And I guess it's about people thinking about how do they facilitate and enable participation for that young person, just as if they were any other young person. Oftentimes, I think in my experience of working with schools, so I used to manage the Safe Schools program here in Victoria, is that schools kind of sometimes think of all the reasons why a trans or gender diverse young person can't do something, from either changing their name or pronoun to using the toilet that aligns with their gender to participating in sport. They're always thinking of the reasons why they can't, and often it's based kind of on fear rather than thinking, having kind of a bit more of a can-do kind of growth mindset approach to what they can do to enable that participation. Schools should start to think about how they sort of have a more proactive approach to around gender affirmation and thinking about policy and practice that they can put in place. The template that I have produced that goes along with this resource that I wrote is a great template that can sort of facilitate some conversations at even school around how to support that child. Having training and education for teachers, so whether talking to the various human rights and equal opportunity commissions in different states, they often have trainers. Again, on that list that's been provided to you, there'll be in your state or territory people that can provide training. But if there's no one that can provide it, you can do it. You can also, you know, as Janet mentioned, you know, watch videos and YouTube clips and deliver it yourself. And then I guess in terms of curriculum, having a more inclusive curriculum, don't wait to have a trans or gender diverse or non-binary student at your school, but making sure your curriculum is inclusive and talks about diversity and all in a really positive way and celebrates diversity, so that if it becomes part of the natural language and conversation at the school that, you know, we're all different, but we're all different and we should be celebrated. Those sorts of things. So kind of, I guess it's about normalising the fact that trans and gender diverse and non-binary students exist, getting yourselves ahead of the game and having policy and practice in place and training teachers and having an inclusive curriculum. Thinking about what are the ways we can actively encourage participation and involvement and engagement in school. I think that's probably a bit of a summary. Thanks, Ben.
Thanks, Susan. Yeah, cheers. Michelle, question for you. In terms of research, what's the best research on long-term outcomes for trans and gender-diverse children?
Yeah, so there are a number of key studies that look at outcomes for different aspects of transition. And I've provided the links that will be available after this for those papers. There are studies looking at social transition and in younger children and looking at the outcomes for depression and anxiety primarily in younger children. And comparing that to rates of depression and anxiety in children generally. And what the outcomes of the social transition studies are showing is that young children who are enabled to socially transition as per their wish to do so, their mental health outcomes are essentially equivalent to those of their peers, their cisgender peers. There are studies looking at puberty blockers and a recent study by Littman, which is in the resources, that really looks at large numbers of trans and gender diverse young adults who were either essentially looking at those who had access to puberty blockers compared to those who wanted access but were unable to access blockers for whatever reason. And looking at their outcomes. And what that study showed was that those who wanted puberty blockers, who could access puberty blockers, had significantly lower rates of suicidal ideation in their adult life. There are some studies from Amsterdam. So the Utrecht Gender Service in Amsterdam is the probably the is the leading service internationally in terms of the duration of supporting gender diverse, trans, non-binary young people and adults. And they've looked at the outcomes for children that have been able to access puberty blockers, gender-affirming hormones, and for some of those young people accessing trans-affirmative surgery in early adulthood. And they showed that depression and anxiety and general quality of life and well-being was essentially equivalent to the general population in the Netherlands. And actually they did better in some of the educational vocational follow-up studies. So lots of positive studies. Also just of note, in terms of long-term studies, I alluded to the study from the Amsterdam cohort looking at regret. And that really looked at regret from the perspective of all patients that had gone through that clinic. So that was nearly 6,800 people, which would include children, adolescents and adults who had gone through their system over the period of time from 1972 to 2015. So, and they were that was the study looking at the low regret rates and rates of social regret, as well as regret for treatment for other reasons. So those key studies are available in the resources attached, and it's worth having a look at them. I think I might leave it there, actually. Thank you.
Thanks, Michelle. I might stay with you just for a second, if I may, because there's been lots of questions from David and others in the chat room, really about this idea, the function of stigma and negative publicity. And it seems to me much of the work that you've been doing in this field has really been trying to demystify the issue and cut through some of the negative questioning that might occur throughout society. Do you have a sense, Michelle, that the research that is coming out about this issue is being effective and being able to do that?
Yeah, I think what the research reflects is what we see on an everyday basis in our clinics, and that is essentially that children and adolescents and young adults, when they are well supported by their families, their schools, and their wider community, we see them reaching their potential, absolutely thriving in terms of the outcomes of their studies or their work, and they function at a very, very high level. For those who don't have the support of their families, which is usually the key aspect of determining outcomes, for those that experience negativity on an everyday level at home and then experience stigma, discrimination and bullying and abuse at school or in the wider community, their outcomes are often very poor. And it's not difficult to understand the role of stigma and discrimination, especially when these young people are literally experiencing it everywhere they go, where there's no safe place and it's happening every day. The accumulative harm and the accumulative trauma that that results has a very negative impact. And to me, it seems like common sense that if we can reduce that accumulative harm and that trauma through support, whichever way that might be, their outcomes and their quality of life are just going to be so much better. I think the negativity in the media is it's a complex issue, and it's driven by lots of different factors, be they political, religious, or social in other contexts. And I think what they're often intended to do is to reduce equality in society and to prevent young people from accessing support and through invalidation of their feelings and their sense of self. We haven't seen numbers drop off at all over the last year when there has been an increase in negative publicity. In fact, the last year we've seen the largest increase in referrals that we've seen for some years. I'm not quite sure what that means, but it certainly has a big impact for those that we are seeing and trying to support.
Thank you so much, Michelle. Janet, a question for you. There's lots and lots of questions. I know that Suzanne answered a question about schools previously, but lots of questions coming through about what schools can do. And from your perspective, wondering what practices, strategies and supports can we implement in schools to support trans and gender diverse children and their families?
Thanks, Dan. I think if you have a child at the school who is actually transitioning, then a transition plan for that student is really important, so that the student, the parents and the teachers know exactly what the agreements are, and it gives a level of certainty to all those interested parties. I think having in the school library diverse stories and references for teachers and students is really important. I know for the two schools that my daughter's been at, we've donated to the school books, so that those books and stories are available for teachers and students to have a look at. Like I mentioned before, with the Australian Story documentary, that was shown to my child's Year 9 class, and that was a really important way of supporting her and also us as a family. And I know the key teacher that reached out to us said that even if our daughter didn't come back to the school, she felt it was a really important learning opportunity for that school to have around diversity. There's also a whole range of other ways of tapping into resources, like I think people have mentioned before, using Respectful Relationships Program, if that's at the school, Safe Schools, if it's available in your state, and youth groups such as Minus 18, Y Gender, and supports such as Transcend. It's great for that information to be available in schools, because often if the child's not supported at home, it's really more difficult for that child to be aware of what's there to support them. I think that's probably overlapping a bit with what Suzanne said, but hopefully there's a bit of new stuff there too.
Yeah, no, it was fantastic. Thank you, Janet. Nick, a bit of a practical question for you. In terms of funding gender transition, what is and is not covered by Medicare?
Okay, Dan. So many affirmative medical services are Medicare subsidised, but there are some significant omissions as well. Amongst things which are supported through Medicare, for example, psychology via the BOMI scheme with a GP mental health care plan. Voice training can be supported by an EPC referral to a speech therapist, part of a GP care plan and team care arrangement. In regard to hormones, estrogen and anti-androgens, that's spironolactone or soprodrone, are readily accessible on PBS general benefit, including you can get authorities for increased quantities if required without any difficulty. There's various formulations of testosterone which are PBS subsidised, but on authority requiring a paediatrician, endocrinologist or sexual health physician to be involved, which may be, for many adults, certainly can raise a problematic barrier. Not covered by Medicare, GnRH analogues are not PBS listed as puberty blockers, but in some states they're available through public hospitals, which seems appropriate where gender services are state funded. In regards to surgery, there's many different procedures which may be relevant, depending, of course, upon individual wishes. Hysterectomy is available through the public hospital system, but one needs to be mindful of the level of trans literacy, if you like, and sensitivity when choosing where to refer. Chest reconstructive or top surgery or gender reassignment bottom surgery are not MBS supported, but for many people it's worth taking out suitable private health insurance and they can get some worthwhile rebate through that. So that's just a brief synopsis.
Thank you so much, Nick. Look, we've got so many great questions coming through, but we are starting to get towards the end of tonight's presentation. So what I'm going to do now is just invite our four panellists each just to spend a couple of minutes just to leave us with any final thoughts or to sum up their thoughts on the issue. Susanne, if okay, I might start with you in that process.
Sure. Just final thoughts. I suppose just what I was talking about at the very beginning of my presentation, I think, yeah, putting the child at the centre of the conversation is so important, and encouraging self-advocacy, because, as I said, that's going to be, so important as the child grows up, and they'll be needing to negotiate and advocate for themselves through lots and lots of systems. I think reflecting on systems that there are throughout a trans or gender diverse person's life, lots of barriers in lots of systems as they move through education, into TAFE or to university, and that, again, about how we kind of build resilience in people and families to have to negotiate that there's a lot of discrimination that occurs, and that can wear a person and a family down, where it just feels like at every turn they're having to negotiate or educate someone or a system to make it work for them as it should, oftentimes a human right. And then just the final thing about the bullying, I didn't really mention, but if you are talking to a school or supporting a child and their family about bullying, is that to use policy that schools will have in place, doesn't matter what school it is, I'm very sure, that every school should have a policy around bullying. They'll also likely have a policy around student wellbeing. They'll have a policy around duty of care. And all of these policies can be used to help advocate for that child and the family for that bullying, and also just for the health and wellbeing of that child to be supported whilst they're at school.
Great. Thank you. Thanks so much, Susanne. Janet, I might now ask you just to... For a final thought.
I think that supporting your child as a parent and finding good support for you and your child are probably the most important things, thinking back on our journey. Peer support, like I said, for me was invaluable in those early days when we really didn't have permission from our child to speak to anyone in our immediate family, friendship or community. And having said that, I guess I come back to that point that I made at the beginning, which is that you do want your child to take the lead, but sometimes your child doesn't feel like they're in a position to take the lead, and that's when you need to kind of take that lead for them, but making sure that what you're doing is with your child at the centre of all the decisions you're making, so that those decisions are based on what they need, not what you particularly need, if that makes sense.
Certainly does. Thank you, Janet. Nick, final thoughts from you?
Well, just to summarise, I think that it's clear that many transgender, transgender diverse, non-binary people experience stigmatisation in every day of their lives, and so including, unfortunately, sometimes within the healthcare system. And so it's really important to acknowledge that they typically approach a GP with some trepidation, feeling quite vulnerable. So it's that initial consultation and engagement is crucial. I think it's really important for GPs to develop some knowledge of the available options and services and pathways within your local area, and really important that the child and the family are at the centre of their own journey and their own care. But GPs are ideally placed to be a cornerstone, as I said, to provide some consistent support and to assist with coordinating referrals and helping to navigate the system.
Thank you so much, Nick. Michelle, finally to you for some final thoughts.
Yeah, one of the things that Nick said earlier was around waiting lists and the importance of supporting transgender, diverse and non-binary young people during that time. And I think I just want to emphasise how absolutely vital that support is in the community. If you have a young person who comes to you who wants care and you're not quite sure what to do in terms of where to refer or who to refer to, there are multidisciplinary public clinics for young people across the country, and we're always willing to take a call to have a discussion on what the best pathway might be. And it's really important that we all work together, not only during that waiting period time, which is a really important time, but also once they are connected to the services, maintaining that local connection with local supports is the way to, I guess, improving their outcomes holistically and into adult life. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Michelle. I'd really like to thank all our panellists tonight. To the almost 1,100 of you who have joined us tonight, it's fantastic to see so much interest in this topic and to all of the great questions that have come through tonight. Thank you all. So before we end tonight, many of our panellists talked about resources and further reading, and so other supporting resources associated with this webinar can be found by clicking on the light blue supporting resources icon. So really recommend you do that. And for further information about Emerging Minds, please visit our website on www.emergingminds.com.au. So remember, MHPN and Emerging Minds have some upcoming webinars. An Aboriginal Children and the Effects of Intergenerational Trauma will be on Monday, the 4th of May. And the next MHPN webinar will be Working with Children and Families During the Coronavirus Outbreak, which will be on Thursday, the 30th of April. So we'd really love you to complete the feedback survey before you log out, which is the yellow icon. And just remember that these surveys do help us to get better at what we do. Statement of attendance for this webinar will be issued to you within 4 to 6 weeks. And each participant will be sent a link to the recording of this webinar and associated online resources within 4 to 6 weeks. So this webinar was co-produced by MHPN, Emerging Minds, for the Emerging Minds National Workforce Centre Child Mental Health Project. The Child Mental Health Workforce Project is funded by the Australian Government of Health under the National Support for Child and Youth Mental Health Program. So MHPN supports the engagement and ongoing maintenance of practitioner networks where clinicians from different disciplines meet regularly with other mental health practitioners, share tips and resources, build local referral pathways, and engage in CDP activities. Due to the current environment, most MHPN networks have been postponed. However, some are organising Zoom meetings. Please contact your local coordinator or MHPN. To learn more about joining your local practitioner network and special interest groups, please contact MHPN or go to the news section on the website. You can also indicate your interest in your exit survey. So before I close and say thank you to everyone for tuning in, I'd like to acknowledge the consumers and carers who have lived with mental health illness in the past and those who continue to live with mental illness in the present. Thank you for everyone for participating tonight. Good night.